It's moving, kind of moving down the ridge line towards the north pretty good. It's not a skinny finger anymore. Nothing, no worries yet, but it's actually cleaning up a good chunk of this ridge line. It's moving north, yeah, away from the crew. That edge of that finger is moving pretty good down the ridge line.
On the afternoon of May 20th, the slide fire was reported toward the south end of Oak Creek Canyon between Flagstaff and Sedona, Arizona. The first evening and night after ignition, firefighters raced to protect more than 300 homes and cabins that sat nestled between Oak Creek and the walls of the steep, narrow canyon that bears its name. Amazingly, no homes or other structures were lost in the critical first 24 hours, or even later when the fire pushed up the canyon and began to threaten neighborhoods on the outskirts of Flagstaff. Much of the terrain is steep and rugged, not the type of country that firefighters prefer for taking on a fire directly. So after the initial threat to the homes passed, fire managers decided to take an indirect approach, using confine-and-contain strategy. Over the course of several days, crews along the north and northwest flanks of the fire staged burnout operations, igniting low-intensity fires using drip torches along the roads and trails to halt the advance of the main head of the fire. In areas that were difficult and dangerous to access, helicopters dropped PSDs, perforated spherical devices, think ping pong balls filled with combustible chemicals, to light fires on the canyon rim and on the tops of slopes and ridges. These firing operations robbed the main fire front of the fuel it needed to make runs up the canyon. Although this strategy increased the total acreage burned, it lessened negative impacts to the forest, the watershed, and the threatened and endangered species such as the Mexican spotted owl. Most importantly, this approach provided for the safety of the more than 1,200 firefighters working on the fire. Within the fire footprint, a variable mosaic burn pattern formed within a few areas scorched by high-intensity fire. In these blackened areas, most of the trees were killed and vegetation was consumed. However, larger green areas with lower-intensity fire effects surrounded these few black pockets. Here, the fire moved across the forest floor, burning grasses, shrubs, and dead fuel on the ground. Most trees survived with their canopies intact. Much of the burnout operations were conducted at night to take advantage of high humidity and low temperature, which helped keep fire intensities low. The overall impact of the firing operations was very similar to that of a controlled burn, and fire officials believe that the burnouts will have considerable benefits for the forest over the next few years. In the new era of multiple objective fire management, there is increased flexibility to accomplish suppression and protection objectives while still working to minimize negative impacts on the forest and resources.
Well, many of the fire suppression techniques can have impacts on ecosystem properties, particularly those that disturb the earth, dozers and even wide hand lines. Or hand lines that are left unrehabbed after the fire's over. The use of aerial delivered retardant is also somewhat controversial and can impact fisheries or other aquatic ecosystems if dropped in those systems. A direct hit is obviously going to have some damage.
Then there's things like burnouts, which can be, depending on how they're implemented, they can be pretty severe, so you can see a lot of vegetation killed by those kinds of actions.
But if you're just lighting up huge areas during severe weather conditions and extreme conditions, you're getting severe fire effects. So there's a lot of direct and indirect and cumulative environmental impacts that come from fire suppression. It's not necessarily protecting or preserving forest ecosystems.
If the local unit can provide a map that has all of their threatened and endangered species habitat, that has all of their values at risk, their archaeological sites, those kinds of things identified, that's a huge help. But not only do they need those places identified on a map, they also need to have some kind of information of what they want from that. So for instance, if you're looking at Mexican spotted owl habitat, you might actually want fire in there, but of low severity. And so that needs to be clearly articulated to the management team, is that that's exactly what you want. You don't want it necessarily protected from fire, you just want more of a low severity fire. And then the management team can then say, okay, well maybe we'll backburn it at night or something of the sort and still get fire in that area. While some archaeological sites might have a historical cabin or something, that's definitely a protection response where they don't want fire anywhere near it. So they have a different response to that. So it's not only identifying where you have values, but what those values mean for that incident management team, where we can see fire or where we don't want fire at all, or maybe we even want some high severity fire in some of the higher elevation vegetation types.
I think what we're seeing is a trend towards more indirect tactics and strategies using natural features or man-made features such as roads, and then just burning out from those features makes for a stronger control line and more secure oftentimes, rather than going as we have historically more direct. For example, on the Horseshoe 2 fire, we did that kind of tactic in an area that was very popular for burning habitat. So in the end, that area was preserved from destructive fire and ran low intensity fire through that using that particular tool, and in the end accomplished a desirable outcome.
Another example is the Dameron fire that occurred in southern Utah near St. George the same year, 2005, where a fire had run up into the Pine Valley Wilderness and down into the flats where several communities occurred and isolated ranches and other structures. We were aggressive in containing the fire in the lower portion of the landscape, protecting the communities, but at the same time only flanked the fire as it entered the Pine Mountain, Pine Valley Wilderness, and then did not put fire line in at the head of the fire in the wilderness and allowed it to burn unimpeded in that portion of the fire perimeter. The outcome was a good mosaic burn within the wilderness, and all of the structures and communities in the lower portion were protected.
Every wildfire is an opportunity to treat a landscape. It depends on what the conditions are, weather conditions, etc., are for that specific event. But if we can start to really use those events as opportunities to treat our landscape, I think we'll see a lot more positive effects from fire.
So in the park, we view every ignition as a potential to have some sort of ecological benefit. And having wildfires have ecological benefit doesn't necessarily mean that you have to have a 2,000 or a 10,000 acre fire. And it doesn't mean that the fire has to burn only in low intensity everywhere that it burns. And so we see that fires of different size, different spatial scales, fires that have burned close together, fires that have burned far apart, any of those fires can promote ecological resilience and can promote heterogeneity on the landscape, which is ultimately what we're looking for in our fire management program.
There's always a concern when an outside organization comes in from another area that's not familiar with local conditions.
In some cases, teeny species or other critical habitat may be damaged by suppression activities and may not be damaged by the fire. And so those kinds of bits of information are very important for the team to understand just as soon as they get there or even beforehand.
What is important? Why is it important? And then how important is it? That's what we want to get to, because that's going to help formulate what strategy we want to do, and from that strategy we'll have the tactics. And so for a particular fire, we may have a very intense, aggressive strategy, but when we get to other parts of that fire, it may not be. We may be taking advantage of the landform. We may be taking advantage of those fuel treatments that they may have done.
Often, like resource advisors, are they supply information. I think they need to be right there as part of the team in the decision-making process.
Firefighter safety must and always will come first in the way we respond to fires. And thus, because of the buildup of fuels on many of our wildlands, it's forced us to also be more indirect in our strategies, but really think wisely about successful strategies and weigh those, in terms of different alternatives to responding to fires. So
we need to recognize that the decisions we make today in keeping the footprint of the fire small may come back to haunt us years down the road when fire visits outside again, because we know fire will revisit all of our sites at some point, and and probably sooner rather than later in many of our landscapes due to the way the climate is going.
The indirect tactics used on the slide fire are part of a trend that has been evident across the U.S. Wildfires being managed in ways that can benefit the landscape even while actively suppressing the fire. There's a growing recognition that many of these forests need fire to thin dense vegetation that chokes regeneration and forest health, and also creates favorable settings for more severe fires that can completely consume the forest. Also, climate change has generated hotter and drier weather patterns in the West, and this has led to larger, more intense fires. Fire managers are simply more reluctant to put firefighters out in front of wildfires burning under these extreme conditions. The slide fire is just the latest in a series of recent high-profile fires that reflect the changing realities of wildfire in the western U.S.